Hello students, in this video we will discuss part 1 of the essay Caribbean Literature and its Criteria by Edward Camus Brathwaite. In this portion of the essay, Brathwaite talks about oral literature and written form of literature. He traces the history of Caribbean literature from 1920 to 1960. He talks about the different dialects of West Indies and the role played by Caribbean voices in fostering Caribbean literature. The essay begins with a statement, Caribbean literature began in inverted commas in 1920s. Now, the author uses the term inverted commas just to show that it was written form of literature that began in 1920, whereas the oral form of literature was there from a long time. And he says, during this period, among artists, scholars and intellectuals, there was an increasing awareness that they have to write both in oral tradition as well as in the written form. Talking about the written form of literature that began in 1920, Brathwaite says it involves certain novels and short stories written by West Indians and one or two Englishmen who lived in West Indies. They try to describe what was West Indies about and what the Caribbean was about. Novels and short stories of this period were influenced by Victorian English novel and were very romantic in nature. In the year 1930, during that period, there were novels of social reality. The writer who stands out from this period is Claude MacLeod. He wrote the first Caribbean novel which had a sense of social reality, and he employed a bit of local dialect. Claude was concerned with the question of belongingness. Where does one find his home? That was a question he asked in his work. Is it the place where one settles down, or is it where one was born? This kind of concern was increasingly found in Caribbean literature. We know all the settlers of Caribbean islands were either from Africa or from India. So the sense of belongingness, rootlessness, alienation always tormented them. By the year 1950, there was a great efflorescence in West Indian writing. Lot of works started coming during this time. There was a flowering of West Indian writing. For the purpose of the essay, Brathwaite uses the terms West Indies and Caribbean synonymously. However, he also makes a distinction of them, and he says Caribbean is a slightly larger term that refers to the whole region, whereas West Indies refers to the English-speaking islands of the Caribbean. And then he talks about the different dialects of West Indies. He says, in West Indies, all the major languages are European. There is no native language except the few Amerindians, because most of the native people were wiped off the Caribbean islands before the English came to settle there. Therefore, the written literature is all in the languages of France, Holland, Spain and England. And when we say dialect, it is a different version of English, French, Dutch or Spanish, which the common people speak. Brathwaite uses the term descendants of Caliban to refer to the common people. We know Caliban is a character from Shakespeare's Tempest, and Caliban stands for the colonized people. And he says, when we speak of a form of English, but it is a form of English which has very strong African elements in it. So the English spoken by Caribbean people is a mixture of English and African. And in some places like Guyana or Trinidad, the English is mixed with elements of India and China also. So these elements of Africa and Asia mixed with English gives the English language a characteristic West Indian flavor. So he says, in each of the Caribbean territories, there is a slight variation of dialect. For example, in Barbados and Jamaica, the mixture is with African languages. English is mixed with African languages. In Trinidad and Guyana, the mixture of English is with African and Indian. The tonal quality is different. For this reason, there can be quite a lot of experiments that can be made with this kind of language. He says, by the year we reached 1950, writers like George Lamming, Samuel Selwyn and others began to use language with the natural rhythms of people, with the kind of drama that is typical of our people. And then he talks about how Caribbean writers started moving towards the metropoles in search of subsistence. For reasons of employment and other, they started moving towards the metropolis. In 1950s, Caribbean writing centered in London around the BBC program Caribbean Voices, run by Henry Swanson. Now, Caribbean Voices was a program of the BBC. Initially, it was for the West Indian soldiers who were working in the British Army to give them an opportunity to connect with family at home during the Second World War. And in this radio program, letters were read to the family in Caribbean islands. The soldiers, whoever wrote letters, those letters were read by people in this program so that it could reach their family in Caribbean. And by the time Henry Swanson came to the BBC, he made the program a form of creative workshop around the craft of writing, in which authors were offered encouragement and informed criticism. By the time this Henry Swanson retired, there was a paper, the Times Literary Supplement, which wrote, West Indian writers freely acknowledge their debt to the BBC for its encouragement, financial and aesthetic. Without that encouragement, the birth of a Caribbean literature would have been slower and even more painful than it has been. So, the role of Caribbean Voices in fostering creative literature is stressed by Brathwaite. He says, Caribbean Voices became a kind of oral literary magazine. English criticism showed great interest in these writers until the 1960s, when writers began to be interested in the local Caribbean audience and to occupy themselves with styles and concerns that were not part of the romantic vision of the colonies. And then he says, some writers like Lemming and Naipaul wanted to return to their native land of Caribbean islands, but this was not economically possible. These writers were succeeded by others who never went through the exile. And he talks about another generation of writers who began writing in 1960s. He says, these locally formed writers were part of the frustrations of 1960s. This was the time of independence, and they had hopes for a wonderful world of equality and creativity. But all this was thwarted. Even though they got independence, their dreams were not fulfilled. The economic realities, nature of politics, and the nature of education was against their dreams. The education was hopeless. It was still the old colonial education, masked in a kind of independent color, but not really conceiving itself as for the natives. Then he talks about one particular writer of 1960, and his name is Orlando Patterson, and he is an author who belonged to this period. He talks about one particular work by name Children of Sisyphus, and it is based on Camus' existentialist knowledge and philosophy. This is the idea that whatever you try to do, you will fail because of the nature of the structure that you are living in. Orlando Patterson turned this to a very pessimistic view of Caribbean. What he did was to analyze the poverty of Caribbean, not only of economics, but also of ideas, showing that it is very unlikely that we will ever overcome this particular situation. He showed that if you were born in a ghetto, whatever you do, you inevitably return to the ghetto and died in the ghetto, and in a most squalid death, kind of death. So here Brathwaite says writers like Orlando Patterson view the situation of Caribbean islands in a very pessimistic way, and this is not what the writers should do. So this is summary of part one of the essay. We will do part two in the next video. Thank you.